confirm the testimony you're about to give in the matter now pending, but the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth to help you guide?
I did.
Let's see, please, sir. Tell the judge your name, please.
Matt Hester.
Matt, what is your rank with the sheriff's office?
I'm captain of uniform patrol department.
I'm going to put this up here on the screen to try to save us a little time, but did you prepare for me a summary of your background, history, and education?
Yes, sir.
And is this a true and accurate copy that I'm displaying here?
It is, sir.
Judge, this will be a continuation of the Exhibit 20, which is the...
Any objections that come in?
No, sir.
Matt, we're doing this trying to... I'm sorry, I'm going to be so informal. Captain, we're doing this to try to move things along, but you've been in law enforcement for how many years?
This year, probably 23 years.
And you've worked at various departments?
I have, sir.
How long have you been at the sheriff's office?
I came here December of 2016.
All right. And the certifications that you have obtained set forth here?
Yes, sir, they are.
Now, again, you are the captain of the patrol division, correct?
Yes, sir.
All right. And how many officers are within your division?
We run 28 officers in patrol.
And you provided me with an organizational chart for your department. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Now, I'd get it where we can all see it. You, above you would be the chief deputy and the sheriff. So we start there with you as captain of patrol. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
And are all of these positions currently filled, Captain?
Slide it up just a little bit if you could there. There we go. Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, you have over here, within your organizational chart, the K-9 division. Is that right?
That's correct, sir.
Now, do the folks in the K-9 division always perform just patrol duties, or do they have other functions?
No, sir. Two of our K-9 officers are funded through a grant through the North Georgia K-9 Task Force. They are assigned to patrol, and they have several functions within the patrol division, but they're also subject to an on-call status for the counties that are covered under the grant. So if those counties require assistance, then our K-9 officers are responsible for those calls for service.
All right. And do you include, within the 28 officers that you've said are in the patrol division, these three positions in the K-9?
Yes, sir.
You do currently?
Yes, sir.
And so without them, you would have 25?
That's correct, sir.
All right. And are there any other positions within your chain of command that likewise have other duties that they have to perform?
Only myself and the lieutenant. I, of course, don't consider myself a patrol officer in the sense of answering calls for service. And my lieutenant also, he actually serves other functions for me. We don't have an administrative personnel assigned to patrol. So my lieutenant also fills a lot of those roles for me as far as our statistical data and a lot of the day-to-day operations with vehicle maintenance and things like that.
Okay. So what functions do your division perform within the sheriff's office?
We handle all calls for service, from vehicle accidents to general calls for service, domestics, thefts, any calls for crimes or citizen complaints. Our officers are responsible for those, as well as any type of extra patrols, fuel details, anything we get that may need some type of law enforcement presence in the county.
And I understand that the patrol for you, but y'all also perform, you patrol the roads.
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Now, what are the shifts that you operate?
We run 12-hour shifts. 6 a.m., 6 p.m., and 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. Two of the canine officers work 12 to 12, one on each rotation of those 12-hour shifts. And then we have one additional officer that works 12 to 12 on one of those rotations.
Yeah. And So how many officers would you have per shift?
We have 5 officers per shift, and then at noon to midnight on one rotation, you'll have a canine officer and one other officer. So 7 between 12 to midnight.
And the canine officers, are they intended for specific functions or purposes?
Yes, sir. The canine officers are typically what we use for more of our proactive type patrol, and I kind of explained the difference between proactive and reactive, but our canines, we prefer to use them for proactive patrol, traffic enforcement, or to assist with drug searches in residence, things of that nature. They get used heavily, though, for personnel tracks as well. If we have an individual that runs as a result of a crime, or if another county has individuals to include runaway or missing children or elderly individuals that wander away from their homes, the canines also fill those roles for us.
And Captain, are there any specific standards or recommendations for a sufficient number of law enforcement personnel within your division of the Sheriff's Office?
I'm familiar with the recommendation.
From the Sheriff's Association?
Yes, sir, from the Georgia Sheriff's Association.
And from your years of experience, do you believe you have sufficient number of deputies within your division?
Based on what and clearing reports and seeing the activity our officers doing, currently I don't think we do.
Why?
Because our officers have, and this is since my time here in 2016, we have generally 2 principles of patrol we operate on. We do reactive and we do proactive patrol. Proactive is generally we generate our own activity. They're on the roadways, especially in the evening time hours or times what we generally consider high crime times. The officers are out there and they're patrolling problematic areas or, as an example, inside subdivisions when we're having a rash of Arenados. With the current personnel we have, we're more in a reactive stance. And what I mean by that is they respond to calls for service and probably don't have as much time to generate that proactive activity. They literally go from call to call to call in a 12-hour shift, as opposed to maybe aggressively looking for criminal activity as it's afoot. This comes in the form of multiple accidents. We have a large growth in commercial population around here, the outlet mall being one of our largest draws. Just an example that we've experienced there is there's a different type of criminal element that has come along with that type of commercial growth. We've seen a more aggressive and probably more focused type of criminal activity, whereas before we may have a shoplifter, we may now get teams of shoplifters that come in 3 and 4 at a time, and they're more apt to run from our officers, be a little more aggressive in the way that they may steal from these businesses, and they're much more organized. So what that results in is we send an officer to a shoplifting, it now has become a 2-officer call because ultimately there's going to be more than one offender. They're probably not going to be easily obtained. We've had multiple cases where they've ran from us, we've incurred damage where they've struck vehicles, they've involved other agencies in their flight from our apprehension. So it's calls that's really generated officers having to respond with multiple officers, as opposed to before we may have had one officer able to handle that particular type of incident.
Let me ask you a couple things based upon that response. When you say respond call to call, I know,
yes, sir.
You understand that, but can
correct.
You just explain
yes.
to the judge specifically what you're talking
Absolutely.
About?
Absolutely. If officers respond to an accident, the county's broken down into zones, and basically we try to keep officers within those respective zones, and those are their areas of responsibility. As a officer receives a call, unless it's a critical pending call, they work the calls within their particular zone or beat. If they clear a call in that zone or beat, what is happening is they generally have another call waiting when they finish that particular call. If they're working that accident, they may have a theft waiting at a store, or they may have a neighbor dispute pending their completion of one call to go to the next call. There's not a lot of downtime between them responding to calls for service.
And you mentioned the zones.
Yes, sir.
For the county. Explain to the judge the zones into which the county is divided for purposes of your division of the Sheriff's Office.
Yes, sir. We call them 5 zones, but a while back, I think prior to me getting here, they kind of combine 2 of the zones, which are in Dawsonville Common, and a few of the others. But as an example, Georgia 400, everything east down there is divided into zone 1 and 5. So two officers would operate in that central corridor of the commercial area, and then the other parts of the county are divided likewise into other zones, and that's the respective areas the officers will operate in.
All right. And what kind of travel distance are we talking about? First in distance and then in time? For example, if you got to get up the big canoe.
Yes, sir. Dawson County is a large geographic area. The upper end of the county is not as densely populated, the west side of the county is not going to be as densely populated as the eastern side of the county. And what that typically results in, if we have an incident that happens up there, we have a delayed response time because it is sparse. Residents are spread further apart. If there are businesses, they may be further from a central or commonly traveled roadway. And then when we have multiple calls that come in, what that results in, the zone officer may be en route to that call, but if it's a heated domestic or what typically we see a lot of is severe automobile accidents where we know we'll have to have multiple officers to direct traffic, it produces a delayed response time because of the geographic region they're having to travel across. Dawsonville is 200 plus square miles, and there are instances where officers may have to travel, you know, nearly from one end of that county to the other to respond to a call.
And in your chain of command, Captain, you have Captain of Patrol and then Lieutenant Assistant Commander and then on down. So you have a supervisory position.
Yes, sir. The shifts are broke down. Each one will have a sergeant who runs each shift, and then they have a corporal directly under them, and then generally three patrol officers. The sergeant's responsible for the daily operations of that shift. They are the supervisor, and best perception is late in the evening or on a weekend when no one else is per se operational within the agency, they're the highest ranking law enforcement authority to make those supervisory calls. Another kind of situation we deal with is those sergeants, instead of being per se a shift only supervisor, they have to answer calls as well. They're not just a shift supervisor. They may work those accidents, they may work those domestics. And what we have to rely on is those sergeants to do double duty of a shift supervisor as well as a zone officer.
So what happens, Captain, if the sergeant or the shift supervisor is out on patrol or a call and a call for assistance comes in?
What they're going to have to typically do, if they cannot break away from the call they're on, they have to, while working whatever they're on, try to find another officer that's close enough to respond to that. There are going to be those decisions day to day that need to be made by a shift supervisor. That sergeant can try to pull away. In cases that don't happen, then we have to rely heavily on that individual officer who's answering that call. Sergeants are sergeants for a reason. They typically have more training and more experience, and that's why we rely on them heavily to run these shifts. However, they do get busy, and we don't always have the luxury of having them make those supervisory calls, and you have to rely on those sometimes less experienced officers to do that.
And what would having more personnel available for those purposes, how would your circumstances change as it relates to what you just described?
A shift supervisor ideally would have the ability to roam basically the entire county. They would have free reign of the county to spot check and or assist officers in critical calls, or at least those calls that may require someone else's forethought or a little more experience to make a sound decision on.
Now, as to training, based upon your certification, training appears to be important to you, is that correct?
That's correct, sir.
Does that assist you in performing your duties as a law enforcement officer?
It does, sir.
And does the number of people available within the patrol division allow for the training you believe to be appropriate?
I would say no. The reality behind it is we are required to have 20 hours a year by post standards. That's a bare minimum. That covers just a few specific areas that we know we need to update our training in annually. Advanced training typically runs about 40 hours, so basically a week. It's where we'll look at specialized classes. Even supervisory type classes are typically 40 hours. Pulling an officer off shift for a week can be kind of detrimental to the shift itself. When you're only operating with five personnel, that means someone's probably going to wind up having to cover that individual's gap while they receive that training. What that translates to is not a lot of folks get to go to advanced type training. Training that's going to, you know, exceed a day or two typically is going to put some type of strain on a shift operating in a 12-hour span.
And in fact, have you specifically encountered that happening at the center here?
We have. It happens from time to time. You know, there are several specialized trainings out there we would like our officers to be advanced in, or, you know, at least just to further their current base knowledge, because when an officer leaves, you know, basic mandate, they get basically just that. It's just in the name of it, basic information to go out there and function as a patrol officer once we've given them internal field training. There are specialized skills, and honestly, law enforcement is a constantly evolving and changing creature daily. Technology alone changes annually on us, and we have to get training in that. Freeing people up to take that type of training to allow them to actually function as we progress forward is imperative, but we don't always have the numbers to do that.
Right. And just, I understand there's a number of courses, but in general, when you talk about the specialized training, tell the judge what areas you're talking about.
Specifically, like I mentioned, our supervisors. We prefer to give our supervisors advanced supervisor training just to learn how to deal with people in specific trends that are facing us in law enforcement. There are accident investigation classes that teach the officers how to process the scene of an actual accident more efficiently. We have criminal procedure classes that update them on search and seizure laws outside of what we've normally just experienced in a basic mandate type class. There's specialized tactics classes dealing with building clearing or even advanced crime scene processing. All of those kind of weigh in to perform or to give us a better rounded officer.
Now, are the number of calls increasing since you've become captain of your division?
Yes, sir.
And then what I mean by that is number of calls for law enforcement service.
Yes, sir.
And do y'all have any administrative personnel within your division?
No, sir.
All right. So who prepares reports then?
Typically my lieutenant. I have him do all the overseeing of the reports once they come in from the individual officers. We split a lot of the administrative duties between us to get some of the paperwork funneled to the general locations we needed, or to make sure that things get processed in a way to get them over to the courts.
Okay. And does that have any impact or effect on timely delivering those reports?
Quite possibly. Another aspect of the officers going from, as we talked about earlier, from one call to another service call, it does delay report writing in some senses. At the end of the day, if they have ran from one service call to another, reports aren't done. And if at the end of the shift at 6 and they still have 5 calls back, or 5 reports pending they've not completed yet, we either have to allow them to stay over to complete those, or we have to wait till they come back in. If it's the end of a shift, well, they may not come back in for 2 more days. So we have to make that judgment call of getting the critical reports in a timely manner, and then the lieutenant has to get to them in time to process them, to push them all the way through our our records management system.
Okay. And does that require them working overtime, or a salaried officer staying over?
They're gonna work overtime to complete those critical reports. Anything where we know there's gonna be a good possibility that our investigations division may need to follow up on it, you know, the next day possibly. Or if it's a critical accident or some of these cases where we know we need to have that information there and available, generally they're going to be staying over to complete those reports.
And Captain, does the lack of a sufficient number of staff that you described, does that affect your ability to enforce the traffic laws?
Absolutely. We have a very dense daytime commercial population. The 400 corridor, which I know referred to a lot, but it's a very congested area, and you know, typically one way we solve a lot of our specific issues when it comes to traffic infractions is we just try to have an officer presence in areas we know that are either high accident or honestly we receive citizen complaints from. Sometimes just that marked vehicle or seeing a patrol vehicle sitting on the side of the road with their blue lights on can be a general deterrent for certain types of traffic infractions. We don't have a lot of that currently, because officers don't have a lot of spare time per se in a 12-hour shift to do that type of proactive enforcement.
And you're familiar with the study it's in evidence, that the Georgia Sheriff's Association that you described.
I am, sir.
And do your the deputies that report to you, do they have one-third of their time to perform patrol function?
Possibly on some days, but it's pretty rare that we're going to say they have that amount of time to do just proactive enforcement.
And what is more customary?
Customary is calls for service.
And in connection with the ability to enforce traffic laws, have you seen an increase in the fatality rate for traffic?
I know in 2016 to 17, we had 67 more accidents in 17 and 5 more fatalities from 16 to 17.
Captain, is the patrol division of the Dawson County Sheriff's Office able to preserve the peace and enforce the law as efficiently or as effectively as if it was staffed as you believe it should be?
No, sir. I believe we could do much better with adequate manpower to provide that proactive enforcement. Do we maintain a level of safety and security for this county? I believe we maintain it, but I believe we do it with a very strained day-to-day operation.
Yeah, are y'all able to have meetings in between shifts where you can go over what's happening within the county?
No, sir, we do not.
And why is that?
And honestly, in my first time in 20 plus years, the first agency I've worked at, we don't do shift change. Typically, shift change is where, especially the shift supervisors, exchange information before the next shift goes on. We may pass along information about wanted individuals, about areas that are problematic for the specific areas of the county, or certain things we need to look for throughout the shift. There may be certain activity that only occurs in the evenings, and the day shift may receive that information and pass it on at shift change. We don't do that currently because, well, one, we don't really pay the officers to come in early to sit down to have a shift change, but we currently don't have the time. If officers come in, generally by the time they hit the county line, they're going to work. If they come in at 5:45, there's probably a call waiting on them.
Now, if funding was provided and it was requested for a SWAT, would you be the commander?
Yes, sir.
What is Dawson County unable to do without a SWAT that it could do otherwise?
SWAT, typically we're going to use it for those critical type incidents that requires more training, more expertise, and honestly, more specialized equipment. Coming from Forsyth County in 2016, I was Forsyth County SWAT commander, and we responded several times to assist Dawson County with certain types of critical incidents because there wasn't manpower. There also wasn't that specialized training needed to resolve certain types of situations.
And if in Forsyth County you were unavailable, that service just would not be provided, if I understand correctly?
Yes, sir. I guess unless they can find another team willing to assist in that.
Have you encountered any other issues that you wish to describe to the judge as a result of the insufficient staffing of your division?
The only other thing that really impacts us directly is without adequate personnel, officers, just like going to training, there's not a lot of time for officers to really take a lot of time. There's not a lot of openings for sickness. There's not a lot of openings for individuals to take that, in my opinion, much needed personal time. They have vacation time. They earn it. We don't always allow them to take it if we're short-staffed. We have the flu running right now. It's hard to release a lot of officers when you have people that are out sick or you've got training pending, or we have a lot of officers tied up in court. It doesn't really come around very often. We can free up more than one or two officers from a specific shift.
And finally, again, on the canine officers, you rely upon them to complete your division, if I understand it correctly.
That's correct, sir.
Do you rely upon any of the other divisions at any time, or do you have to assist them?
Both. We assist other divisions as needed. We assist CID with search warrants and things of that nature. We assist the detention center if they have inmates that are going to stay overnight in hospitals, things of that nature. We've assisted in providing security for those type of details. I also supervise the school resource officers. We use the school resource officers to assist outside of normal school hours with various things from working accidents to responding to calls for service. In the off-school time, I rely on them heavily to function in a patrol-type function. Yes, sir. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Is it common for counties with population similar to Dawson County population, 20,000 to 25,000 folks, to have their own SWAT team in preparation on staff as opposed to relying on mutual aid?
I don't know if you'd call it common. I spent 12 years as the charter vice president of the Georgia Tactical Officers Association. And had the opportunity to travel around the state, do a lot of assessments on SWAT teams. And I don't know if I can call it a common practice. I think it's about a split down the middle. Lots of times mutual aid is beneficial for personnel members. But I also started and operated Lumpkin County SWAT team for about 8 to 10 years on a very similar population growth and number of officers that we have here currently.
In the event Forsyth County is not able, does Hall County have a SWAT team?
They do, sir.
What other counties close by, either adjacent to us or adjacent to one of those, have SWAT teams?
The one I'm most familiar with, of course, is Forsyth County, Hall County, and I'm familiar that Lumpkin has a small team. If I can expand on that a little bit, the reality of dealing with that is SWAT type functions or what we would consider a need for SWAT is generally imperative based upon response. In other words, the opportunity or having the ability to get those particular elements in place when a critical incident begins. A delayed response often can change the outcome of that incident. We know we're not going to send a SWAT team to an active shooter because an active shooter situation is going to be over before a SWAT team gets there. A barricaded gunman or a hostage situation, it's going to be imperative to have those critical elements in place before that situation deteriorates beyond the point we can hopefully have a peaceful resolution. So I guess going back to the question about a common practice, I don't know if there's a commonality to it as far as size or population or even agency size, but I think the need is there based on your ability to deal with an incident as it evolves. The quicker you have that element available and can put it in place, you're generally going to have a better outcome or resolution to that incident.
What you've done before, does it would make it easier, possibly more effective to have it than to not have it?
That's correct, sir.
Does the Georgia State Patrol assist Dawson County Sheriff's Office with traffic patrol?
Absolutely. Most importantly, we use the Georgia State Patrol to assist us with vehicle accidents. Our standing policy now is, or standing practice, we notify them when we have motor vehicle accidents. If they have an extended ETA, then we try to dispatch an officer to go ahead and work that vehicle accident. If the Georgia State Patrol is available within a reasonable time, they will pick those accidents up. And then any type of fatality accident, we're going to turn over to Georgia State Patrol regardless.
Does Georgia State Patrol, for lack of a better term, perform traffic patrol on Highway 400?
I honestly am not familiar what their practices are. I know that the post that we currently use, which is the Cummins post in Forsyth County, they service Forsyth County, Lumpkin County, and us, but I'm not sure what their practices are outside of responding to accidents for us.
Do you know one way or another whether they make traffic stops?
Yes, sir, they do.
Do they make as many as Dawson County Sheriff's Office patrol does?
That I'm not familiar with.
Don't know.
No, sir, I don't.
Who does most of the DUI cases in Dawson County? Dawson County Sheriff's Office or State Patrol?
I'm not sure what their numbers are based against ours, honestly.
I think that's all we have. Thank you, sir.
Redirect?
No, thank you. You come down and be excused, John.
Any objections to the witness being released?
No, sir.
You release me from the attendance, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, sir.
Call me next witness.